Vodkast. Hey everybody, Jeff Manchester, welcome to the Vodkast podcast, which is being broadcast from this bomb shelter I call an apartment. Sorry. For those of you listening on iTunes, you've been spared, and that's why it's good to listen there. And you can listen to me there. Just type in Vodkast into the Apple whatever podcast app. I don't know how it works. I'm not on Stitcher or SoundCloud or whatever. I'm just keeping this simple. Keeping it simple for me. Anyway, so if you want to ask me a question, vodkastpodcaster@gmail.com. We have four questions today. These are all questions from people. I'd say if these fit into some kind of theme, it's the beginners, people starting out, people having to make tough choices about should I move, should I stay, girlfriends, boyfriends, husbands, wives, real sort of messy, emotional human stuff that gets involved when it comes to making choices about following your dreams and following your passions. And maybe one day, if you follow your dreams and your passions, you will, I mean, look around, look at this place, huh? I mean, this could be you, right? That's all I'm trying to say. Scotchcast. It could be a vodcast, but I've got the scotch. This is an isotope glass. Very elegant. Nothing but luxury. Let's move into the questions. The first one is from Emil. He is 17. It's not like I know that. He writes it in the first part of the... I'll just read the friggin' question. I am a 17-year-old music passionate from Finland, and I'm particularly interested in composition and soundtrack making for movies or media, or whatever media. I just discovered your channel. Very nice videos, by the way. Thank you, Emil. Or tak. I don't know. That's Norwegian. Tusen tak. I don't know. It's the same in Finland. Probably not. Sorry if you've already answered this question or similar questions, but I was thinking about what you had done yourself in terms of studies or preparation in order to become a composer? Thank you for your help. Thanks for being passionate, Emil. I know you asked this one a little while ago. Let's get to it. Okay. Little confession here. I can't read music very well, and I was never technically trained to play, I guess, the piano, which is probably the most important instrument just in terms of getting around a keyboard, because it's on the keyboard through MIDI. That we can manipulate, you know, effects and virtual instruments and all the rest of it. So that's why in one of the earlier videos I talked about really getting used to the keyboard, not your keyboard and mousepad keyboard, but your MIDI controller, and really getting familiar with, you know, a 49 key setup or a 61 or whatever you have, just so that, you know, it's very fluid, and learning about, you know, the circle of fifths and all this stuff. The good news is I mean, like, I hate to say this because I don't mean to sound self-deprecating for effect, but like, if I can do it, anyone can do it. You know what I mean? You're 17. You have a lot of time to learn these things. And even people who are my age and older, there is so much excellent content on YouTube. I've talked a lot about a number of free or platforms with free content. Lynda.com, if you're in Toronto, a library card or access to the public library system in this city at least gets you access to lynda.com. And I know for a fact that there are a lot of excellent tutorials for people who want to learn about composition and arrangement, and also creating realistic MIDI, you know what I mean? And that's sort of stuff that I have definitely, I can vouch for. It's excellent content. So there are all kinds of ways to self-learn if you're not interested in school. And if you're 17, even if you're a little older, I think that spending time in like a, you know, brick and mortar classroom, I think there's something really sacred about the classroom learning environment and learning experience, and having a dialogue with your colleagues and your professor and your instructors and all the rest of it. That isn't to say that, you know, if you don't go to school or if you don't whatever, you can't learn. Of course you can learn. I think really all you really need is passion, but that's not really enough. I think that you'll find that after a while you might hit a wall creatively because you only know a certain amount of chord patterns, or you're only really familiar working in the key of C or something like that. And pretty soon you'll have a sound, whether you know it or not, that isn't, you know, isn't really something you want to be associated with. You want to be a bit more flexible and versatile. And that's where the supplementary learning, like on lynda.com or whatever, comes up, as far as getting a library card and all the rest of it. But I know that my girlfriend, she goes to school here, obviously, but her university has an agreement with lynda.com where if you're a student, where she goes anyway, you get access to all their stuff for free as well. So there might be some sort of educational, you know, partnership that you're, I guess you're 17, so you're probably in high school. Yeah, you're probably like grade 11 or something. I don't know how it works in Finland, but you probably have access, at least at a university level, to some kind of, you know, free content sort of system. And I encourage you to take advantage of it, to learn as much as you can. But that being said, I mean, I took piano lessons and I hated them. And who knew they would have come in so handy? I have, like, woman fingers, which is nothing disparaging about women, obviously. But, I mean, they're very long and, you know what I mean? Like, they just look like, I don't know, it's gross, you know. My wrists are small and the cuff of a sweater just kind of dangles off of it like I'm not a real man. But it's very good for playing the piano and guitar and all this stuff, you know what I mean? Like, anyway, so long, narrow fingers will get you a long way. Ugh. Anyway, let's move out of this question. Hopefully that answers your question, Emil. Yeah, so I mean, in terms of studies or preparation to become a composer, no. I consumed a lot of media and alcohol in my path to becoming a better, more well-rounded and more versatile composer. And just doing it every day helps too, because you'll improve in a sort of, in a way that you don't expect. It just sort of comes naturally. If you're going to the gym every day, you know, you're not going to see results after 1 or 2 days. But if you just keep going, before you know it, people will start going, oh, have you lost weight? And you're like, oh, yeah, you know, it just happens. You just keep composing and you keep learning and you keep trying. And then pretty soon, you know, if you've uploaded your stuff to a SoundCloud or you have some sort of archive of your material, you'll go back, you know, you're 17. When you hit 18, you'll go back to when you were 17, listen to the stuff you made a year ago, and you'll really hear the progression, I think. So, yeah, hopefully that answers your question. Let's move on to the next. I'm going to take a little sip here. A little sippy, sippy, dippy. This is from Louise, and he wrote to me, vodcastpodcast@gmail.com. So he says, hey, I hope I'm sending this to the right person. I don't know why I read this. I don't know why you can't just read the question. I always read like the sentences around the question. Anyway. Well, comma, my situation is, comma, it's like I'm reading like a stenographer or something. I was invited to some projects, but I don't know if I should ask for a price for music. Now, it's impossible because I'm far into the project. How should I ask for money? Okay, this sucks. I have been there. You sign on to something and then you find yourself doing so much work. There's two ways to go about this. You could approach it from one angle, which is just to keep your head down and be thankful that you learned so much and that you, you know, that you really grew in whatever sort of capacity as a, I'm not sure what you said that you are, music. I'm not really sure what you're involved in, but, you know, sometimes the best ways to learn, a lot about people and a lot about your own craft is to just parachute yourself into situations where you're overworked. And the amount of stuff coming your way is just really difficult at first, and you get through it and you're like, oh, I'll never do that again, because you learn, you know, you sharpen your intuition so that when the next guy comes along and says, hey, I heard you're into music, do you want to come help me? You're like, your intuition is like, no, I had a terrible experience, I know exactly what I'm getting into with you, this is my rate. Or anyway, I'm just saying, the other route you could go, which isn't, I mean, it's kind of risky, but you could say, listen, I've been here for a while, I know you're really passionate about what you do, and I'm really passionate about what I do. And I feel like at this point, I've put in the hours and I've showed my value to you in ways X, Y, and Z, and I think I deserve to be compensated. The reason I say it's a bit risky is because they could just like fire you. But the reason it's not that risky is because if you're late into the project and you've become really sort of like an embedded reporter in this insane thing that's going on, you're in it now. If they cut you loose, if they sacked you, then like they'd have to find someone else to fill your shoes. And often when you reach the sort of, when you're getting close to the finish line of these projects after you've done all kinds of work, they're not gonna, you know, they're not gonna go on Craigslist and try and find someone and then educate him or her as to everything that you did before, you know, they got ready or whatever. It's just not gonna happen. So sometimes being like, listen, I don't want to be a problem here, but I put a lot of work into this. And then, you know, I mean, they might recognize that and say, okay, you know what? I can't pay you now and I can't pay you after this, but I guarantee you that you will be on my next project and we will definitely have a conversation about payment, which gets to the sort of final point about this. And that's that you have to stick up for yourself when you walk into these situations. And, but the thing is, you can't stick up for yourself unless you've been in situations enough to know that, you know, oh, this is one of those things that I'm walking into. You know, you sort of blindly accept jobs and then you do them. Well, that's why these moments, I think, are very helpful, Luis, is because you walk into them, you go through it, you get your battle scars, and then you're like, your intuition is very sharp, so that the next time someone comes around and says, hey, I got like a 2-3 day thing, I don't know, you know, location, on location recording or something like that, you know right away, it's not going to be 2-3 days. I know exactly what kind of project this is. It's going to be like a rinky-dink two-man show, and I'm going to be doing all the work. And that's when you say, yeah, sure, but here's my rate, and here's my availability, and get back to me, you know. If they can't pay you, then you have to decide if it's worth it for you to go ahead and do it for free. And I've done a lot of stuff for free, and I've always, always, always given it like 110%. And I've been dragged around like you, you know. I've been dragged around, just one more shoot, or oh, we'll do it one more day, or don't worry, we just have like two more things to do, and then we'll be totally done. You get there, it's 7 hours that go by because someone's, you know, absent or whatever. But you walk through those experiences and you learn a ton from them. And I think that anyone who shies away from free stuff, like free, not free stuff, but unpaid work, you know, you might be missing out on a really cool opportunity. So many jobs, especially in this industry, show up, happen because people show up. They're just there. And maybe someone else is sick that day and you're doing two jobs. And then they're like, well, you're way better than the guy that was sick that, you know, we're paying. What, do you want to do this again? You know, the next time we do something like this. So, again, without specifics of exactly the nature of this particular job that you're doing, I can't really, you know, say what the environment might be like for you. But anyway, my advice would be to either stick it out now, learn a whole bunch, and be really polite about the whole thing. Don't burn bridges and be that guy. I know it sucks because you want to really, you know, especially when you get to the end of it and you do a great job and they might have treated you like dirt. Try and be diplomatic and polite and nice, and, you know, because there might be someone else involved in that project that will remember just how great you were and be like, yeah, I saw how they treated you. Listen, I have something and I was really impressed by your skills. And anyway, this is just how it works, man. People walk into these things, they do it for free. And before they know it, someone falls ill, someone can't do it, someone dies, whatever, and they take their place. And that's how, you know, that's how a lot of careers start, is just from the people who just, you know, they're out there working really hard and pursuing their passion, often, you know, for free at a great personal cost, you know, away from their loved ones, or, you know, missing out on paid employment, whatever. Anyway, so hopefully that helps. Let's move on to another question. But I feel for you, man. That's a really crappy thing to be in. The next one is from Rudolph, and I have never met a Rudolph in my life. This is very exciting for me. Not that we've met, but here we go. Okay, so he says, hey man, just want to say thank you for all the videos you upload. There are a lot of us interested in this type of work, but sadly, not enough of us for it to be highlighted and talked about more often. I'm looking into college soon and wanted to know your opinion of on it for this line of work. What courses in college be worth it? I think there's a typo there. Or should I focus on self-teaching more? Also, I've always wanted to compose and create my own tracks for movies and TV, but I fear I have a lack of creativity. Are there other routes I can go to work with music in movies/TV without being an actual producer? You probably get a lot of messages. I don't assume you'll reply to this, but it's worth a shot. Any help is seriously appreciated, and thank you again for all you do for the community. Well, Rudolph, you are very, very welcome. Let's unpack. There's a lot of stuff here that you want to talk about. So the first thing you say is, there are a lot of us interested in this type of work, but not enough of us for it to be highlighted and talked about more often. Keep in mind, I'm just going to highlight this so I know where I left off. Keep in mind, Rudolph, that not everyone likes to do this. Like, you know, not everyone likes to be teaching other people, and not everyone wants to be either on camera doing a podcast or whatever. Like, I really enjoy being on camera. I enjoy meeting people, and I enjoy getting the satisfaction out of, you know, feeling like I'm helping people. But it could be that you just have this perception that the industry and the scene is really lacking. And this is, yeah, there's great people. They have other commitments and responsibilities, and they can't be in front of a camera. A lot of people either don't want to teach, or they don't think they'd be very good at it, and they'd actually be really good at it. In fact, one of the guys that I first met, he actually made me want to go to recording school. He was like that for me. I mean, he was a teacher's assistant, a TA, and he was one of the greatest guys, just incredible. But he had this big sort of like, I'm not sure if it was like an imposter syndrome thing, if you know what I'm talking about, Rudolph. It's this idea that you don't really belong there, and pretty soon you'll be found out because, you know, you don't really know anything. You just sort of like, you barely get by, and, you know, you say all the right things at the right times, but if you slipped up once, everybody would realize you don't know anything. You know, he might have had that. There might have been a crisis of confidence or something like that, but I really wish that more people who feel that way didn't, because they have a lot to teach other people. And anyway, so that being said, I'm just saying it could be that your perception might be a bit skewed because of I get what you're saying. There's not a lot of people sharing the knowledge. And if they are sharing the knowledge, it might be for other reasons, to either blow up a brand or something like that. But anyway, thanks for saying that my voice is appreciated in this space, in this learning sort of space. But if you see people or on YouTube or whatever, and maybe they have not a very high subscriber count or view count or whatever, and they're really trying to do tutorials or whatever, like, and you really like what they do, then you should encourage them, because there's so many people that start things. I see blogs all the time, Facebook, you know, people. There's this one story about this guy who did, Pro Tools Expert, the guy who runs that, extremely successful. But somebody else was like, hey, I saw your blog and I was just so, I was just so inspired by it, and I've always wanted to do it and I never felt that I could. And then I saw you do it and it just opened the door for me. And this guy who runs Pro Tools Expert was talking about this, and he said, I had no animosity, or not animosity. There's no jealousy or envy or anything like that. I responded to him. I said, that's great. You go do your thing and have fun or whatever. And the guy says, and then, a couple months went by and he's like, I actually went back to that email and I checked out his Facebook page to see what he was doing, what he was up to, maybe scoping out competition, nascent competition or something. And it turns out that this guy, he posted for like maybe a couple of weeks and then it just fell dead. And he had like a lot of subscribers, like he was doing really, really well. And then for whatever reason, it just petered out and that was it. So all this to say, gosh, that was a weird tangent. Just be nice to people who are trying. Okay. Would courses in college be worth it, or should I focus on teaching more? I'm not sure what you mean. Like, do you mean about composing? Or, if I go back to YouTube and I look at I don't see anything indicating exactly what you mean. If you're talking about composing, or talking about going to school for composing, or going to school to teach composing or audio engineering or whatever. So that's a little fuzzy to me, and I don't want to give some big answer that isn't relevant to you. But I did this thing a while ago. It's one of the first videos on this channel, which you might want to visit, which is like, audio engineering school, is it worth it? And I think in that video, I sort of very clearly lay out my own experience, because I think it's kind of foolish to make like a, should you go to audio, and like, for me it's more about the value of it depending on your own commitment and your own goals and whatever. So I would say that one of the things that I did was I had a very good understanding of what I wanted to do in the industry, which was compose and make my music sound better. So I paid close attention to the kind of people that were teaching at these sort of institutions, the for-profit or whatever. I looked at, the list of them, and I'd Google them, and I'd look them up on LinkedIn, or I'd look and see if they had like a Discogs page, and just see if, the stuff that they were teaching, or the pedigrees from which they came, the careers they had before they started teaching, lined up with my own goals. And that's because there's this thing that someone said to me a long time ago, a professor actually, not at audio school, but in university. And he said, go to where you think you'll learn the most from the people around you. And that's so true. And that was true, because when I went to audio engineering school, even though there's no like composing element to audio engineering. I went to audio engineering school because I was composing, but I wanted to make my stuff sound really good. And I knew that I had to have a pretty good understanding of how audio behaved in the digital space and in the analog acoustic space. So, but there are a lot of people who edited, a couple of people who wrote for short films or whatever, but the emphasis was more on audio and the fundamentals of audio. But I learned so much, and I knew that I would, because the people teaching at that school, just they knew their stuff. And I think that's really important considering a college or any sort of higher education in audio. So I would, that would be my, you know, if you should focus on teaching more, I don't know, or sorry, self-teaching, my bad, self-teaching. I would say self-teaching should supplement whatever you're doing. So if you're going to school and you're doing this full-time or part-time or whatever, you should be going home, going to Lynda, going to YouTube, going to Manchester Music. That's stupid. Anyway, just you should be supplementing your, you know, your in-class knowledge with tutorials and educational content. And there's tons of great places to go. I've talked about them a lot on my channel. Anyway, so the next part of your question is, I always wanted to compose and create my own tracks for movies and TV, but I fear I have a lack of creativity. You know, everyone feels this way. I always thought that I had a lack of creativity until money was involved. And I'm not being cheeky. Like, it's true. The minute I moved from like a... just making tracks in my bedroom for me sort of system into a making tracks for client sort of system, when there is a living, breathing person that has money for you, or not even money, but just the expectation of completion of work, that will get the creative juices going pretty quick. And if it doesn't happen, you know, if you got a week to compose something and nothing happens for the first 6 days, on day seven, you know, the day before the deadline, you will compose something really beautiful. There's just something about that pressure that works for me. Also just immersing myself in the music really helps. So whenever I'm about to compose a film, I always listen to a lot of film music. I did a black and white short film recently called I Fub You. And I was in another interview talking about this, about how I got going, you know, how I sort of, you know, got into a state of play, which is what you need to be in when you're composing, a state of play and joy and happiness and excitement. And it was from just listening over and over to black and white, or no, sorry, silent films, because the film Fub that I was working on was silent and it was black and white. And I thought, well, there's not a lot of silent movies out there these days. And then I remembered that every Pixar movie has a movie that opens that movie, a short film that is always inevitably silent. I mean, it's not silent in that there's no Foley or sound effects, but there's typically very little dialogue at all, unless characters are singing. So I just watched a load of those, and they're on YouTube. You can watch them on iTunes or whatever you want to do. And I got really inspired by one called Paperman for the Fub movie. And so I kind of drew inspiration from that. And there's another one, which I can't remember. It just won Best Oscar, and it was done here in Montreal in Canada. So I forget the name of it, but it's about a bird on the ocean. Anyway, it won for Best Animated Short, I think. And Moana didn't win for some reason, which is just ridiculous. Anyway, so those two movies really got me on the track to be creative. And knowing you have clients and people who expect something from you, that's huge. So I would say that helped my lack of creativity. And also I have a video on my channel, which is like ways to start, stay focused and finish your music. I highly suggest you go and find that on my YouTube channel. It's one of the first things that I did there too. So that might help you get out of a creative rut of sorts, should you find yourself in one. The next thing is, are there any other routes I can go to work with music in movies/TV without being an actual producer? That's tricky. I don't know. I don't know of any other. I mean, there are networking things that you can do. Certainly starting a YouTube channel was helpful for me because it just got my face and voice out there. Now, that being said, I have not gotten a single composing gig from being on YouTube. I just haven't. I've met people in the industry who might know other people, but my job as a composer has never been helped at all as far as networking and meeting someone else on YouTube. But it might just help get your name out there, you know, it might help you establish a bit more credibility or even prestige as a composer if you have a sort of channel and a body of work that's viewable online and you're there talking about what you love. That might help. But I find, you know, going to audio engineering school, just being in environments where people are passionate about the same things that you're passionate about, that really helps. You don't get gigs staying home, like, ever. So you have to get out and see what's happening. If there's a workshop, for example, there's a place called Long McQuaid. It's a music place. They had this workshop for, you know, video game composing. Even though you're not going to probably meet a director there, you might meet someone that knows, you know what I mean? Like, that's how it works. So you have to actually get out and get to the gig, as a good friend from Isotope once told me. So get to the gig, get out, Now, whether or not you can, you know, do this without being a producer, I have a funny sort of I have a funny relationship with the word producer, because today a producer means like, oh, I'm a beat maker, artist, blah blah blah. But to me, it's like, you know, you're a composer, you're an artist. A producer is, to me, that's more of an administrative thing. They set up the sessions and they get the artist to the gig and they negotiate the rates for studio time. And to producer, just, it's just such a static, stuffy word for what is such a creative, inorganic process that is, you know, actually taking ideas in your head and getting them out into the world and sharing them with people to produce. It irks me. So I don't know what other routes you can go beyond networking a whole bunch, being a really great person that people really want to work with. And I've talked about this before on the channel. A lot of people have a lot of great ideas. They're extremely creative. They have the means and the knowledge to get started as a composer, but they just do not have anything close to resembling professionalism, like nothing. Like, they send their emails and it's all lowercase, or they're visibly and uncontrollably high, or, you know, they can't put together like a shirt and pants combo. And what you're doing when you do that, when you can't do those things, you're basically, you have like a big sign around your neck that says, I am not someone that you want to work with. Because this is we're just a very judgmental sort of system in society. And so when you're putting yourself out there, you have to be aware that what you do and what you say and how you look and smell, all that stuff is communicating something about you. So that's really important. Passion sometimes just isn't enough. You have to sort of pick yourself up and clean yourself off and be someone that people actually want to work with. And then go home and just like get in your underwear and drink and record a podcast. All right, the next question comes to us from Steve Carter. He says, hey, Jeff. I stumbled onto your YouTube site from your Spitfire LCO walkthrough. Brilliant library, right? Yes, it is. It's awesome. And found your YouTube and the Vodkast to be incredibly helpful for emerging composers. Useful, he says. Thank you. I appreciate your good-natured attitude. And have learned a lot, or you've reaffirmed some thoughts I've had. So I commend you for doing what you do. Please keep it up. Absolutely, I will. If you're open to suggestions, I'd love to see some content on how composers can network in the digital landscape. I have my own way of finding work, he says. I don't know what that means. As I'm sure you do as well, but would love to hear about some new possibilities. All right. We're not living in the must be LA, New York, London world anymore. That's true. So how can you go about making an impression on directors who might be long distance? Have you ever felt you might be missing out on a project because you weren't in the city the film was being made in? Also, I really dig the work I heard from you on SoundCloud. Thank you. All the best, Steve Carter. Okay, let's talk. Let's talk about networking and being in the moment and getting to the gig and all that stuff. Now, have I found that my being in Toronto has been a hindrance to the ability for me to get work, get meaningful work? It's hard because I don't know what I've missed out on, but there are times when I feel like if I was forget, you know, Toronto, but like just out of Canada, if I was in Los Angeles or something, I mean, I heard this story, I'm not really sure if it's true, but in one of these composing books about a young man who bumps into a car in Los Angeles. He's a composer, struggling composer, on his way to like a fast food job. And the fellow in the car in front of him, who he has bumped into, just so happens to be a director, and they hit it off, you know. So there is something to be said for moving to places where a lot of creative work is just flown around. What you have to be aware of, I think, is there is just as much work that you can get, I think, if you're in. Here's the thing, it doesn't hurt. Like, does it hurt to be, like, I'm not sure how to put it in a pithy sort of way that can, like a bumper sticker sort of way, but it doesn't hurt to be in Los Angeles, New York, or London. It really doesn't. I spoke to Keegan DeWitt a while ago, and on his Twitter it said that he lived in like some part of the South, and I was like, oh, great, you know, here's, we can talk about this thing. And I did a, like a little hello introduction. He's like, I'm like, hey, you're from the South. He's like, no, I'm in LA. I'm like, okay. So I really feel like for people who, for some people, that's a really big thing. And there's a lot of pluses to LA. The weather is gorgeous and, you know, it's fairly liberal if that's your thing. And, you know, so there's that. And there's also a lot of work happening. But I don't know if it's ever been a big problem for me that I'm in Toronto. I mean, I get to do the channel and it shows up in a suggested video, and then people click on it and learn something. But I mean, to your point, Steve, like I've never gotten a composing gig. Like no, there's no director going like, let's look at isotope reviews to see if we can find a composer for our feature. Like no, you know what I mean? Like no one does that. So I'd say it doesn't hurt to move. It's such a big sacrifice, though. You know, it's like a huge thing. I grew up, my dad was a Mountie. I don't know if that means anything to you, Steve, but military, you know. So we moved every 2 years. So I know what it's like. It's, they say next to, I forget what it is, it's the most stressful experience you can have, especially as you get older, because you might attach yourself to someone. And then they have to come along for the ride and leave everything because you want to. You want your name in the credits. So, you know, these are really tough, important choices to make. I've gotten a good deal of work as a composer just being here in Toronto. That being said, I don't like, I'm so busy now doing other stuff for companies. Like, I do a lot of demos and walkthroughs and stuff like that. That, like, the composing stuff, I get like a gig. I'm good with the amount of gigs that I get. Like, I don't have that many credits on IMDb. People are always like, I had one guy, he emailed me, he's from like Spain or something, and he wanted to like apprentice under me. And I'm just like, dude, I am not, like, I'm not Hans Zimmer. I don't like look at this place. You know what I mean? This, ooh. So I'm not like a top, I mean, I've done feature films and documentaries and a load of short films and, you know, but I do a lot of other stuff too. That's the thing that a lot of people might not realize about the channel, is that I do a lot of like dialogue editing. I do a lot of mixing and mastering. I do some recording, although I find sitting in a room with like five guys who are checking their phone while some guy's, you know, on the live floor trying to get a drum sound. To me, that's like exercising a moment in masochism. So I don't do it that much. But yeah, I do a lot of other stuff that keeps me really busy and frankly really happy. And so when a composing thing comes around, I'm like, oh great, you know, I you know, it's not like I'm coming off this composer sweatshop thing where I just did like 20 things and I have to do something else. I can keep it kind of fresh, which I like. I can kind of control the amount of composing that I do. But I certainly think, to your point, Steve, that if I was in London, if I was in New York, if I was certainly in LA, the hustle, you know, all that stuff, I mean, there's work there, you know, it's there if you want to go out and grab it. If you want to stay wherever you are in you know, one of those non-cities, there's Mandy.com and Craigslist, and you can set up little recipes to make sure that you get a link every time on like if this, then that, right? Every time someone types the word composer into Craigslist, you get a ping, and you know, there's ways to do it. And also just getting really familiar with like the artistic milieu of whatever city you're in. So meeting directors and writers and going to short film festivals, or we have TIFF here in Toronto, which is like TIFF. I mean, TIFF is like genius, right? Because TIFF is like New York, London, LA, Vancouver, all these things in one. It's international too. It's not just domestic. It's like out in Europe too. So I'd say a way to, you know, do it on the cheap is to come to Toronto and just go to TIFF and have a bunch of business cards and don't be a doink, you know what I mean? And just introduce yourself. And, you know, and that's the other thing about networking is there's like a fine line between networking and then wasting your friggin' life. So you have to make sure you know that you're not wasting your life and that you're spending more time learning and becoming a better composer than just like schmoozing and wasting money and time and all that stuff. I think, did I answer everything in your question? I'm just going to go back and make sure. Oh, do I have my own way of finding work? You know what? I'll take a sip here. I gave the origin story of my like evolution as a composer and how I got into the industry to a guy on his YouTube channel the other day, and maybe this will be helpful to you if I do it here too. So I'm gonna take a sip here in 1 second. Okay, do I have my own way of finding work? Well, how I even got started might be useful to you, so I might as well just walk you through it, Steve. I was this friend named Matt Hines at Isotope, and he was like, where did it all begin, Jeff? And just every time I think of like starting a story or anything, a sentence, I just have his face going, how did it all begin? Anyway, no one cares. Okay, so I was wanting to be an actor for a very long time. I want to be an actor. I even went to New York. I went to New York City. Steve is like, has already turned the podcast off at this point. okay, so I went to New York City. I wanted to be an actor, and I went to this school called New York Academy of Dramatic Arts to audition, and I actually got in. This is like the same school that, like, you know, Anne Hathaway and Adrian Brody and Danny DeVito, and anyway, they all got into this. It was like a big deal, and, you know, I was just too scared, and I didn't have a lot of money, and I would need like $40,000 a year to go, like, or like per semester, something just ludicrous. So I was like, I'm not going to do this. But I kept acting alive. And I kept it sort of going, you know, and then I moved into music and I really love music and everything, but I always kept it sort of just burning, you know? And when I got to Toronto, I remember I was DJing at a bar. There used to be a bar called Autash. It's not here anymore because they got rid of all the hookah bars. So it's not there, but I used to DJ there. And one of the servers was an actress, and I, you know, we got to know each other really well. And I remember just hearing about, you know, her gigs and all that. And actually, she went to the New York Academy of Dramatic Arts, which was hilarious. I didn't let on that I didn't want to be like this failed guy next to her, a DJ. But she went there anyway. So we connected over that, and it kind of got me back into the acting scene in Toronto. And I always kind of kept acting. And one of the things you should know about actors is that, just like composers, they're starving for work. They really need work, and it's very saturated, right? Not as saturated as the composing market, but very saturated. So what a lot of these people do is they will create work for themselves. So they will, for example, you know, they'll take some courses on screenwriting and directing and producing, and then they'll just write, produce, and direct and star in a movie. So they create, you know, work for themselves. And it's just, it's genius. I love it. So anyway, I knew a lot of, what I'm trying to say here, what the point is that I knew a lot of actors who were also directors and writers, so they needed people to do music. I had my girlfriend at the time, I was living with her, and she had a friend stay with us, and that friend was working on a documentary, very successful documentary now, but at the time, you know, she was getting funding and all this stuff, and she happened to tell me that she was looking for a composer, and I was kind of interested in it. I wanted to create music. I was DJing, and I was kind of tired of playing other people's stuff, and I wanted to make my own stuff. And I was just like, well, what do you need? Like, what do you need from this person? So she's like, well, he's in New York. He's kind of flaky, you know, but he's really big and all this stuff, and I just want to get him for this, you know, but he's probably not going to write back. And I was like, okay, well, just show me what you need. What's the temp track you're sending him? And she played it for me, and I listened to it, and I was like, oh my God, like, that's so easy. That's like, you're going to pay some guy to do that? Like, I can do that. You know, I didn't say any of this. I just, like, kept it inside. And it just got me thinking, if I can do that, like, you know, why aren't I doing that? Like, I love movies, I love film music, and it was such a no-brainer, and it was a way for me to be creative, which is what it all kind of comes back to. So it just got me thinking. So I got in touch with a lot of my actor friends who were also directing and writing and producing their own stuff, and I said, just so you know, I am a composer now, you know, and one, the girl that I, you know, that I knew at that bar, she got me in touch with one of her friends who was an actor / writer / director. He actually played one of the characters in the Watch Dogs 2 game. I don't know if there's any gameplay, like the Ubisoft game or whatever. He was one of the guys in the hoodie. Anyway, his name is Jonathan Dubsky. Great guy. So he wrote a movie called, Mars is Laughing at Us. And if you go into my IMDb, it's one of the first credits I have. He came over and we met, and he was like, oh, I'm working on this thing. And I didn't have a keyboard. I was like, I'm a composer. I didn't have a MIDI keyboard. All I had was like an Ableton Push controller, and I was using Ableton. And I had to learn all about, like, he kept sending me emails like, oh, we have the picture lock coming. And I didn't know what the hell he was talking, like, what's a picture lock, you know, and SMPTE and MIDI. And anyway, so I didn't have a keyboard. I just did everything on my Push controller. There was guitars, there was drums, there was piano, you know what I mean? And I just figured out, I could have done it on my actual, like, typing keyboard, but I did it on my Push, no MIDI keyboard. And he loved it, you know, and that was a start. And he introduced me to people, and I reconnected with other actor friends who were also writing, and the new people who were directing and all the rest of it. And that was my little, you know, that was my path. So whether it leads to anything significant down the road, I don't know. I'm getting really busy with other stuff that I'll probably talk about on the channel soon, and I'm really thrilled about it. But I don't know. You know, I mean, that's my path. And I think that's the lesson here is that, man, the days of, you know, of coming up through the system by dusting off light bulbs and, you know, being in a studio and being the guy that the tea boy, right, that gets the tea, like, that's gone. It's gone. You have to almost be an entrepreneur at this point and really be persistent and tenacious and passionate and just like grab people by the scruff and be like, I want to make music for your movie. Like, that's how you have to do it now. It's not, there's no system through which to come up. Is that a sentence? So you have to get creative. And it sounds like in your email to me that you already have a way to get, you know, to get clients and to get people's attention. That's good. That's how you should be thinking about it. And hopefully my way, or the way that I rose up a little bit, I guess, is going to be helpful to you as well. So let that be a lesson to other people who are looking to, you know, to find people to connect with. You have to start somewhere. And for some people, it's starting at the beginning of someone else's career. You know, it's starting at, it's attaching yourself to a director or producer in a sincere way, I might add, in a way that's friendly and nice and like you have similar things in common. You're not just trying to like suck a movie out of them, you know what I mean? And then they realize the friendship was a sham. Like, you have to be, to make nice and make friends with people. And I like a lot of my actor friends and, you know, a lot of them are working on stuff. So it's just like a natural fit, you know? So anyway, hopefully that helps. I think that's it for the Vodkast. It's been a crazy, 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 crazy day here in Toronto for me. And so, with that, if you want to write me a question, if you didn't think I answered one of the questions to your satisfaction, vodcastpodcaster@gmail.com. More videos, more sample library review stuff coming. Sorry. More effects and plugins. I'm thinking of getting into the Brainwork stuff, the Plugin Alliance stuff. They have some really beautiful effects. And anyway, and I'm talking to other companies to get more libraries and more content. And go check out the East West thing that I did recently. I was really impressed by the Composer Cloud series. It was just very a dream to work with and play through, as opposed to downloading piecemeal library by library, which is, you know, it's fine, but, you know, anyway, so thanks for watching.